Before Helen introduces our guests, I just wanted to thank you all for a beautiful concert last Wednesday. Probably one of the best I've heard since I've been here, so congratulations.
Thank you. Really did. As I said in my email to you, I meant every word of it. I just felt such connection that you felt to the music, and it was really a privilege to do that big, monstrous program with you. I felt like maybe you do this every concert, but maybe this was a little bit heavier on heavier side, but it was marvelous. So thank you. And what a treat today that we have Maestro Tito Munoz here. He's currently the music director of Phoenix Symphony in your second season, is that right?
Fourth
season. Oh my goodness, has it already been that long? Okay. And has conducted everywhere and all over. So I don't want to even rob a minute from you. And here is Shostakovich's Symphony. So thank you so much for being here with us. If people are missing, I would just like you to.
Yeah, move up, guys. She's going to be coming.
She's coming? Okay. Got it. Okay.
How many of you played this piece before?
Probably a lot of it, yeah, okay.
Do we have a first one part, by the way, or is that a problem? That's a problem. Okay.
We also don't have percussionists, okay. So Michael.
I know that, yeah. I should tell you that. Right. But we're working on the first one.
Yeah, let's work on that.
Good. They're going to work on that. So those of you who played it, even if you've not played it, maybe you've studied it in class. You might know the story behind it. This is a response that Shostakovich felt like he had to give to Stalin because he was publicly censured. He was publicly slapped on the wrist, which at that time could mean you get killed, actually. But instead, he was too famous at the time for that to happen. It was an opera that he wrote, Lady Macbeth, of mid-sense, and he was critical of Stalin's regime, or at least that's how Stalin took it. And so he felt he had to write this to kind of get him back in his good graces, but he also wrote it with a little bit of a subliminal message to his people, saying that there is light at the end of the time. So, a lot of turmoil. Let's give it a try. Can we begin, please, from 2 before 1? And when we get to this piano section, let's really try to maintain a super soft piano. And you notice I went into 4 and stopped subdividing there. And so that requires you guys to really keep a very, very, very solid subdivision going through 1. And that subdivision needs to be within the expression that this kind of legato is giving you. So you're always feeling that 16th note somewhere inside that expression. Don't lose that feeling of keep it really soft. Okay, 2 before 1, everybody. 2 before 1. This. change of note has to be after their pickup, right? You have to make sure you keep that pickup in your body. Dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee. It has to be exactly with them. Two before one. Here we go. Sorry. I'm going to be very, very picky with you guys. I'm giving you something. Why? Because we're still in a louder dynamic to be when that happens afterwards, right? So here's some. Here. One small thing for all of you, but especially for leaders, yeah? The sniffing. Be very, very careful that when you're keeping time within rest, you want to maintain your rhythm. If you get too pedantic about kind of sniffing through those rests to maintain your rhythm, it becomes static. And then the rests don't have any opportunity to have a feel, you know? So you get too... And it happens a lot because it's good. It's good to feel those in-betweens. But then you hear it in the audience, actually. That percussion, number one, to the audience. But also you get too static, and it's really, really important that you feel, because the rest, even though they're written as rests, they don't always mean exactly the rests that are written in time. So for example, something like, I'll give you an example for the second violins, two bars before three is one place where you have 16th note rests. I mean, you can be real pedantic about that and try to get 16th, but he wants the eighth note to be longer. That's the idea, the longer and longer and longer. It's not really that it has to be some kind of exact thing. Just think about that when you're doing this. And sometimes the leading with the musicianship is much stronger than something that's like this. That's why I'm not subdividing everything. It's actually much better for us. Can we start from one before three? One before three. And seconds and violas, don't be too soft here, because we need to actually diminuendo still a little bit. The 30 seconds, just so you all feel it. It's all really musical. Again, if you get to this, it doesn't work. You have to really think of it. One before three. Is detail for the first violins and for the flute. The flutes have a forte diminuendo where you have an accent on your A. You see that accent, right? So you can write anything. You just have to know that the accent shouldn't be so much. You get it, then you come away. But then when you get to the three bars before four, it's really important that you do use both to kind of make it really, really sing and melodic, but not louder. You have to make sure you maintain some kind of balance with your right hand, so that you're not forcing the sound to be too loud. You're actually doing something like this. So it's really this kind of very, very beautiful but still soft kind of sound. Can we start, please, from same place, one before three. One before three. Yes. Thank you. Okay, those of you who played this before, what happens here? It speeds up, right? It's basically, it's almost as if it's twice as fast. So I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and 2, and 1, and 2. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay? So it's almost going to be like it's in two. So I'll cue you when that happens. Can I have just the strings there? 1/2 bar before 9, just the strings. Right on this thing. Without the harp. So this is 1/2 bar before 9, just the string. I go 1, 2. Good. Great. Let's stay on the upper half. Let's stay on the string and do 2. Just a second, he always tells me. 1, 2. Just stay there the whole way through. All right, good. Can we start, please, from 8? 8. And all of these, once you get to this, the 4th beat of 8, really sustain these notes all the way through into the 16th beat. Okay, 8 directly. One more time, and really give to all the way to the top. Yeah, all the way to the top. Take it. At 13, this is a really, really, how do I put it, a very relaxed resolution when we get to that point. It's 1, 2, so actually you need a lot of breath to really sustain these beautiful soft chords, yeah? Guys, great. So this whole thing relies on the cellos and the inside viols going back and forth with these eight. Really, really important that that's your function, that's your constant back and forth, and that's how they're going to get their momentum to go into the outside of the too. Yeah? Good. Can we go from, just once, from 11? And just watch this hairpin, and do what I do. It's really warm, and it's the top of that hairpin. Yeah? So this is 11. And just one before the quarter notes. One before the quarter notes. Okay. Good. Now, see if you can do that even more organically. without such a huge stop. You know, just they both should go at the same time. Yeah, we have just have more time than you. Same thing, and. But not super, super aggressive. Just really relaxed. So you're not forcing the vibrato. Don't force the vibrato at all. Just really relax. Your left hand should be as easy peasy as possible. And just go. Exactly. Right. Always find the shifts will always be more difficult if you worry about them. Always. If you don't worry about them, magically it'll happen. It's just one of those weird things. You just let them happen, okay? Can I cut everybody now? We don't have to do all of this again. Can we go from, give me 2 before 13. 2 before 13, we'll keep going. Okay. Same thing for the big yellow excerpt. Same thing, don't worry about it. Okay. 2 before 13. Remember what we did before. Like, remember the tempo and the feeling that was what it was. And just take the initiative to do it. You got it there, just go. I don't have a shot. There should be no reason for that. We make music together. It's not you following me, it's we do it together. Yeah, so use your initiative to make that happen. Okay, we're gonna get there, y'all. Can we find a way to just like, let's adjust so that you guys can see. I don't want to have to constantly do this. Let's maybe, how about the oboes move this way just a little bit? Yeah, that would be good. That's better. And then maybe you move just a little bit, the flutes just a little bit to your right. Just a tiny bit. Yeah, since we're a window, then we have that. Okay. Can we start, please, from 14. And the phrase marking that you have there is also so that you can join the first violin. They join you there, and so they need a, that's what happens, yeah, okay? So this is 14, directly. And go. Suggest is that the D flat, you actually shouldn't be already so far up on the G. Actually, have courage to shift up on the G. It's actually a little bit easier though, but not bad. So can I have just the basses, cellos, and piano? The pickup to the second bar 17. Okay? So I'm gonna go 1, 2, 3, and one, two, and three, and one like that. Okay. So this is section 17. Cellos, basses, and piano with the pickup. One and two. Okay, y'all, let's try this again. 15. 15. Everybody, 15. This Popo Anemando before 19, where it starts to get gradually faster and faster and faster. A lot of it's really going to rely on you guys, on the pizzicatos, right before 19 and at 19. But it's really, really important that any kind of a cello rondo needs to feel organic. It needs to feel like it's coming from the intention, from some kind of emotion. It's not just let's just get faster and faster and faster. There has to be a reason for it. And you have to feel it inside. You have to egg people on in order to make it happen. But you also have to know where we're arriving, right? And so where we get to is 22, which is going from 92 to 126. It's actually not that much over a long period of time, yeah? So you have to really pace yourself, and you have to feel these new tempos at beginnings of phrases. And that's where you're going to actually feel this cello rondo work. And if you listen to most recordings of great orchestras, that's sort of how they do it. They always are kind of doing it in sections and using certain moments, key moments that kind of drive it. So you know where those places are because I think they should feel natural to you. Okay, we don't have to do all of this again, but can we start from 22? 22? Okay, and in order for us to have a little bit of a bigger sound, it's not balanced at all and it's not enough in general, stay a little bit more in the string. Really in the string. Okay, so don't bounce too much, don't play it with any kind of lightness. Very, very, very into the string heavy. This is 22. And up. Thank you. But the idea is that when we get to the Lagamente, that we're going to be in a much slower tempo, almost like Rene. That's where we get to, yeah? So it's very, very, very important as we're getting through this from 35 on, that the 16th notes get really, really heavy, heavier and heavier and heavier. Bobby, 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 Bobby. That's what's going to keep you back always and give you that feeling of aggression throughout. Yeah. Can we try from, how about, actually, that's a good place, 35, right at 35. Actually, give me one before that. So this is the second bar of 38. Second bar of 38. Mm-hmm. sorry, can we make sure it's a minor chord? Not, it's a G, not a C sharp. It's a G natural, yeah? Okay, 43 directly? Okay, very good. A minor, and one. Just make sure that you are thinking about this literally as one long phrase from 42 to 43. It literally is this for like, you know, 12 bars or however long it is, yeah? So you have to really make sure that you really, first of all, thinking about how much you need, thinking about where you need to really give the most, which is that crescendo into the forte. That's the surge that just is like super expressive. It needs to come out a lot. Can we actually start there from 42? Directly 42? Between the oboe and the clarinet, the eighth notes, they need to have some kind of really strong emotional relationship to one another. So you can't kind of just throw them off individually. They have to always come from the previous, which means you can't rush them. You have to always think. They're always within the context of the bassoon record. Yeah? So just don't rush them and really play with them. 42. And if I do something that's not that, then I'm wrong. Even though I might blame you as a conductor if you're at a gig, but you will know that I'm aware of it. It has to be whatever they do. That's simple, okay? No matter what anything that they tell you, it has to be. Okay? Just be, that's how you do it in quartet, that's how you do it in chamber music, you always put out the chair, yeah? Let's do one bar before 44. Just give me the C sharp. One bar before 44 for the second. Is one.
Thank you.
the cellist part there, do you? You do, okay, so that's what it is, yeah? You should be able to, with your eyes closed, you should know exactly where those things are, yeah? Good. Do you want to do it again?
Yeah, so I'm sorry, I was missing part.
It's okay, that's fine. Let's go from 44. 44, let's just do this whole ending again, and we'll go on to the next one. 44. What time is it?
48.
4:44 usually happens on the quarter note. Just half quarter note and then the quarter note is usually that's sort of how it comes. Okay.
Second movement.
Do you have all down bows for this? Except for the eighth notes. Everything is a down bow except for the eighth notes. Okay? Yeah. So really, let's see what you mean. Okay? So all downs except for the eighths. Forward. I always play music even if you think the context of the progression. One, two, and. Okay. Not bad, not bad. It's a couple of things we should talk about. For the woodwinds, that first entrance that you have, especially when the for the E flat clarinet, but all the woodwinds at 49, you have a fortissimo and a really massive diminuendo. It has to be this like and then out of the way, like really like you just were doing this to everybody. Yeah. So it has to really come out of the way and be very, very, very playful. And then I would suggest that whenever you have, for example, the crescendo at 50 needs to also be really very, very short eighth note. For the first and second violins, the 453, just mind your accents there. All of a sudden they're on the beats after the one bar of 453. Then I'd also like to just try once, just for a bowing thing. Can we try first and second violins, the entrance after 54, the E's, okay? And especially because I want to make sure that the beat before 55 should end up a down bow.
Okay.
You understand? Then the up bow on the piano, subito piano.
Yes.
Has to be that way. Yeah, if it's written differently, it's wrong. So just to fix it. Yeah? Okay, just make sure, just put a down bow on that so you know that that's what it is, and then an up bow on the piano. Yeah? Okay, can we try that? This is the bar, the entrance after 54 is on the E's, first and second violins. Just make sure you're really thinking da-da-da-da, whatever it is, just make sure really aggressive accent on the last forte part. Yep, same thing, same place. Is one. That's the one that has to be really controlled and aggressive. Into that and then a diminuendo. That's the idea. Good, guys, great. Can I have everybody, please? From 53. All of this will all come back at some point. So 53. And sort of standard procedure, which means that if you go to any orchestra, they will do that before conducting the cello, not to do it. Okay? So just default to that. Always, okay? There's always a long, same thing trumpets when you have it later. Always hold that. Put a dash on that pickup so it's really clear. Yeah? Three before 54. One, two, and. So for the horns, another thing that is a default thing that people usually do is a retard in 257. Something like that, yeah? So just naturally kind of feel like you want to slow down, yeah? Can we do that? This is 2 before 57. Actually, no, give me 5 before 57. 5 before 57. And you can hear her from your way. Okay. 5 to 4:57. 1, 2. It's not too much. It doesn't matter, actually. Play 58.
Sure.
Play 58, just by yourself. Just listen to 58. Okay? Yeah, fair? So just the out-tempo is really a little earlier. That's the idea. It's always sort of kind of goes into the out-tempo. Good. One more time. Pick up to 57. But that's the idea. Good. Thanks. Pick up to 57. Is 1, 2. They can't play graces. That's the idea. A very, very cool little trick, orchestration trick. Yeah, you like plowed through that quarter. Amazing. Okay. And you all did it together. Okay. Good. Bassoon, thank you. Because I know we don't have a conjurer, so thank you for that. So can we actually go from that from right there, 65. And there's one small thing, just for the horns. All of this, especially when you have those second beats, like the 4:64, 1-4, and the bar of, just make sure all of those eighth notes with dots are really short. I mean, they look kind of like it should feel uncomfortably short. You know, that's how it has to be. And it'll sound right over here. So right, that actually sounds quite long. 65, everybody, 65. Without the downbeat, if you could, that's all you have. Just click on. Let's get that. Can I have just piccolo and firsts at 66, just so we have this exactly? Right. Just play exactly what you have, okay? Exactly 66. 1, 2, 60. 1, 2, and. Good. And always, and think of always, even though you don't play an accent, think of an accent on those last notes. Just always think of an accent on the eighth note. Yeah? Let's try that same thing. Without actually forcing the sound. Yeah? Just think of like almost like your finger accent. 1, 2, and. 1, 2. Good. But all of it should be faster and before the. Yeah? So, very fast. Same thing. 1, 2, and. 1, 2. That's much better. Yeah. Can we have 2 before 66 ever done? 2 before 66 ever done. 1, 2. Do you have all three parts in your? Okay, so this is what we're gonna do. You all four will play the third violin. Four of you will play second violin, four of you will play first violin. Okay? That's what we're gonna do. So you all play third violin. You all have the same part. You all have all three of the same. You should. Yes, I agree. And I guess we should do this by stand. For the cellos.
Okay. Well, we have an odd number of stands.
Yeah, well, we can do, I see. Yeah, maybe we need to just do inside outside. That's fine. Let's just do inside outside. Yeah, no, sorry, no. There's a reason why actually that we do front and back because for example second cellos you're with the bassist most of the time outside of your upper violas you're with the third violins in the beginning, for example. So it's actually better that you have like a unit here and a unit there. So let's just do how about three and two. Let's do that. Okay? And then we'll do three and three. How about that? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay? All right, here we go. Third move. Okay. Yeah, yeah. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Okay. 3 and 3. Good. Here we go. Let's start singing. And one. Oh, what's the same? Hold on. I'm gonna change it up. Things to think about. Now, what makes this obviously a lot more difficult is that we don't have enough people. That's just so what you have to do in order, and I'm already taking a little faster than I normally would, and you guys are wanting to go even faster because you're not staying the pose as well as you could. So part of it is just a technical thing. Part of it is understanding that you need more time, right? You need more bow, right? So and there's only a certain amount that you have, so you have to prepare it. But it's not just preparing it, it's actually finding the place on whatever string you are in, between the bridge and the fingerboard, that is the best and easiest sounding point. There's one on every string, and the higher the string, the closer to the bridge it gets, right? Because that's just the tension is more. So as you get to a lower string, or if you're on the A string or on the D string, you want to find that sweet spot, where if you were to just take the open string and put your bow on it, without any pressure of your front and your pinky, it would just sound really quite big. If you sustain it and you just keep it there like this, with this bow hold, you actually find that place on the string that would just sustain full, and it would sound like a French horn metal. Okay? That's the place that you always want to be. Okay, you want to find that place and you always want to be there. So this way, when you're sustaining anything like this, that is the sweet spot where you don't have to work so hard, you can go slow, and you won't have to, if you're not in that spot, it'll sound like that, you know? So you want to reduce that by finding that place. And then, of course, just knowing that you have to save. You just have to save the bow. So we try from the 478. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 478. Okay. And when you're saving your bow, remember the subdivisions of eighths, the subdivisions of quarters, and feel that as music inside the length of the bow. Have to really feel that rhythm within a harmonica. Thank you. This will always be down. I'm leaving going like that. Okay? Okay? So there should be no question. 1 before 78. 1 before 78. First seconds and cellos. We'll break this apart. I want to make sure that we feel comfortable with this. So this is first seconds and cellos on the forte espressivo. Okay? Right on forte espressivo, first seconds and cellos. That's after after 81, right? Here we go. So it's one, two. Before you think of the finger and you think of the shift, think of the pitch itself. Sing it first. Hear it in your head. Know where it is, and then just go to it. If you worry about the finger first, then forget it because you have no context. But you have to think about where it is, and then all of a sudden the finger will come. I mean, you'll know it's a fifth. You'll know it's a fourth. You'll know exactly where it is if you're thinking about the actual pitch. That's it. One, two. From after 81, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 after 81. That's the forte for the strings. 6 after 81. 1 before oboe, 1 before bassoon. 1 before tenor. And 83. Poco pimoso, which means a little bit faster, which means look. Okay? Look at it. Let's try. 82. Beautiful with in the second clarinet. Let's do that one more time from 87, everybody. 87.
Let me just check on the time also, just to make sure. Oh, my phone here.
Good. Okay. Okay, 87. Thank you. take your time. Yeah, yeah, it's fine. Yeah, whatever you need, it's fine. I can't do that as a wind player, right? It's, you know, as a string player, it's fine. 87. You're good? Okay. Okay, 87. The stickiness has to be really intense, more so than anything else. Just the really, really, it's a slow bow with a really sticky articulation. Okay. And for the winds, just as sharp of an articulation on all those accordions. 1 before 89 is.
Thank you.
Just watch your key, guys, three sharps. Third bar of 92 is one. Just change on three. Same thing. It's just four, half notes and quarters. It's not that. Scared first violin, yes, because it's really, really high. Okay, sorry. A couple of things for the innards, you guys. One motive that keeps coming back in this whole thing is dee, and those three notes, like two eighths plus the long one, are always extremely expressive. There's always a really like heaviness to them. So that means they can't rush. They always feel like they are a placement, always a placement. And the last time, he actually stretches them, which is three before 94. He adds an extra bar, dee, and then the resolution is on that. Yeah? So he really is like getting there, always getting to that point, and you always have to feel that tension in that particular rhythm, especially at that time, two before 94. So you really feel that, wow, just falls right into this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. So can we start before that? I don't want to do all this again, but let's just start from before 94. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 8, start. 8 before 94. 8 before 94. On the beat. Is... Thank you. go be with her. She looks at me, you look at her. Excellent. So two small things before we go on. Okay. This seating works if she's over there, actually, because then you guys play together. That's the idea. Just that one little section of the harp and the two violins. But it's okay. So for this, you generally speaking, whenever this is usually done, you just take as much time as you need to get the harmonics out. So you don't have to feel like you're in a momentum, just whatever you need to place and get them out, and then the celesta is supposed to just stare at your hands. And so as long as you are, that's the only way it really works, yeah? Accelerando poco a poco, the best way I think that this really works is that third beat of that bar. That's where it kind of really brightens up, and then we try to maintain something not too fast, because when he writes this 1/4 to your quarter note, which is actually not that fast. Opportunity to maybe play something else. So, let's try. 97. Begin.
Thank you.
Careful, careful. Yeah, just really calm when you're sight reading. Yes, okay. Can we chart 105? 105, straight up? Okay, just directly on 105, not too fast. Sorry, they're giving you a nice, easy... Just stay right with that, okay? 105. 3, 9. But I don't really want to do that fast. Timpani, you don't have to be so polite. You can be a little bit more. I mean, he writes 3 S. She's pretty loud. I know she's right there, but it's okay. Yeah. Okay, guys, not bad. So at 110, with a big tune, it's really, really important that in places like this, where everybody's kind of marked with the same loud dynamic, it's the same, always the same. You want to make sure that you find your function, your character, your whatever, and you want to make sure that your sound is reflective by that. Meaning if you need to be a little bit more transparent, if you need to be a little bit shorter, if you need to have a little bit more character in your sound, then go for it, because that's how we're going to be able to balance. Otherwise, it's just play softer, play louder. You know, that's not the way it really works. It really has to be very musical and with character. So let me start from 1-1-1-0. And so, for instance, in the tune, violins, violas, winds, it's actually a little bit more of a freer sound. It's not this, it's not that. It's a little bit so that the sound projects more, but it's not heavy. Yeah? This is 1-1-0.
Thank you.
This is unfortunately not cyberable. It's not cyberable at all. Actually, it's something you have to look at before you show up. So let's go 2 before 113, and let's just do this very slow, just the first and second volume. Just first and second volume. And the key is what? What is the key for something like this? What helps you?
Don't play.
Yes, but why?
Listen for you to check information.
But for to who and to what? For first violin specifically. Who's playing the lower octave? Play softer. Listen to them. Okay. Sorry, this is 113? Two before 113. And two. Seconds have to play the right note in order for you to play. It's a B natural, right?
Oh, it's part of
the part. Ah, okay. It's B natural. That's why. Yeah, that's fine. Good. 114, first and seconds. 114, 114. 1, 2, 3, and. The idea. So you play soft not only because you want to be able to hear them, but just in general, the upper octave should always be softer than the lower octave. Always. Okay? Good. Now, guys, don't get in there. Your forte is placebo, but you all have marked forte is placebo. You need space to be able to do all of this. Yeah? So can we start now? Everybody, please, 2 bars before 113. Let's just copy this. Okay? 2 before 113.
That's true. Yes. On 114, would you like that up the octave or down the octave?
114?
Yeah. We have an insert.
I have it written as treble clef E. So it should be up. It should be really good the height. It should be up. It's not written correct. It's not the treble clef down the octave. It's the written pitch, I should say. Sorry, guys. Have fun with that. Here we go. 2 before 113. 2 and. We're into the whole way. 115, you reckon? And not bad, guys. Really good, not bad. 115. And. Thank you. remember, you're thinking about this in octaves as well. Just like I was saying with first violins, the cello should always be played into the bass sound. Really thinking about really the inside of that lower octave. So you really are matching that scenario. Right there, 2 before 1 1 9. Directly on 2 before 1 1. Because that's the different rhythm, that one bar, and that's the bar that's going to set us up for the 3-4. Feel like you could go back a little bit with more accent. Dum, da, 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 ya, da, dee, da, dum, ba. So you really feel that going into the 3-4. That'll help us quite a bit. Can we go, please, from 2 before 127. 2 before 127. Let's see if we can get to the end.
Thank you.
very hard. But I do want to make sure that we all know what's happening and that you're really feeling this where it needs to be. So I'd like to try one more time from 129, but I want to just talk through just a couple of small little things. When we get to 129, I'm deliberately kind of letting you guys play this slowly. When we get to 3-4, it should actually pick up, but I'm kind of letting it go. And particularly because at 129 especially, the way he marks the bassoons, horns, and cellos with these accents, there's still a little bit of singing in it, a little bit of sustain. It's not just going. I really feel it that way, and especially when we get to 130, when the trumpets just have forte, you don't have something too loud there, but it still should be full and majestic and not quite so harsh, not yet at least. But then once we get to 131, which I take in this sort of generic two, some people think it's supposed to be in a slower four, some people think it's supposed to be really fast, like the way Bernstein does it. But whatever it is, it still has to have this really grandeur with really good articulation in the strings and the winds, whatever you have, the eighth notes and the quarter notes, with good articulation so we hear it all clearly. Can we start from 129? Actually, no, give me 128. 128. I know it's 7, I appreciate you guys giving me this thing. A couple of minutes. Okay, this is 128. 1, 2, 3. Just be very, very careful. It's right. It's 4 bars of E flat major, not 3 bars. Okay. So can we go from 129? 129.
Thank you.
I don't know what, how you guys were told about this or prepared for this, or I know it's the end of the semester, you guys are all freaking out over juries and all other sorts of things. I guess in one way this is a, kind of a lesson in that you kind of have to be prepared for anything, because the life outside of this is not any easier. And you have to know it. You have to be able to just come in and just do it. And so the more you take things like this with that mindset, not like, oh my God, I have to do this. No, I have to do this. I'm going to figure this out somehow and make it happen. I think the better. So if you guys have an opportunity to read, have an opportunity to just go through rep and try to always focus and learn how to get the little things that will help you along the way, I'd say do it as often as you possibly can. So anyway, thank you all very much.
Yes.